Before we begin part one of our new unit, The United States Enters the World Stage, I want to take a few moments to review some of the things that we studied so far this year. We started the year with a unit on Reconstruction. The time period for that unit was 1865 to 1877. So we were looking at life in America following the Civil War to see how Americans attempted to reconstruct or rebuild the nation. We also looked at the struggle that African Americans faced in the South following slavery's end. We looked at the Civil War amendments that attempted to protect the rights of African Americans and voting restrictions designed by white Southerners to limit the rights of African Americans. We learned about Jim Crow laws that created separate facilities for blacks and whites, and the U.S. Supreme Court case Plessy v. Ferguson, which made those Jim Crow laws legal. In Unit 2, we studied how Native American tribes living on the Great Plains were impacted by the rush of settlers coming from the East to ranch, farm, and mine for gold and silver out on the Great Plains. We studied the Battle of the Little Bighorn, which was the last victory for Native American tribes against the U.S. Army during the Plains Indian Wars, and how the U.S. government attempted to force Native Americans to give up their traditional ways and live more like farmers from the East. We saw that the U.S. government even set up schools for Native American children, which were designed to destroy their culture and language. In Unit 3, we studied the second wave of the Industrial Revolution, which began in America in the 1860s. As I've been mentioning all year, the first several units that we study in 8th grade are all about things that took place in America at roughly the same time, that is, from the end of the Civil War into the early 1900s. So when we looked at industrialization and studied the rise of the great industrialists, or robber barons, depending on how you choose to look at them, we were still looking at life in America from the end of the Civil War into the early 1900s. In this unit, we saw the Transcontinental Railroad connect the East Coast with the West Coast and encourage settlers to move out to the West and give them the opportunity to earn a living. And we looked at the rest of the important industries like the steel industry and the oil industry, and we saw how those great industrialists encouraged the growth of monopolies in America. In Unit 4, we studied the incredible wave of immigration that hit the United States in the 1870s and lasted into the early 1920s. We saw how these new immigrants coming from Southern and Central and Eastern Europe brought very different cultural traditions and religious beliefs and languages that previous immigrants... who had come in the earlier 1800s from places like Great Britain, France, and Germany. We studied the push and pull factors that cause people to leave their home countries and then draw them to new places. We took an in-depth look at Ellis Island, America's great immigration station located in New York Harbor, and we saw that the fear of immigrants that began in the early 1920s led to a limit on immigration known as the quota system. We've just concluded Unit 5 on the Progressive Era, which took place towards the end of that time. In this unit, we looked at all of the reforms that were designed to fix many of the problems that were created by industrialization and immigration. We began the unit by studying the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire and saw that that tragedy ended up leading to new reforms in working conditions and worker safety. The workers began to organize and demand not only those better working conditions, but also a more reasonable 8-hour workday. We learned about muckraking journalists like Jacob Riis and Upton Sinclair, and about reforming politicians like Robert La Follette and Teddy Roosevelt. Now, Unit 6 has two parts to it. The first part, which we'll begin right now, talks about how the United States started to expand its influence overseas. In the second part of the unit, we'll take a look at the role that the United States played in World War I. In both parts of the unit, we'll see that the United States, beginning right around the turn of the 20th century, starts to become a leader in world affairs. And this was a radical change from the isolationist nation that the United States had been for its first 100 years, at the recommendation of its first president, George Washington, who urged the United States not to get involved in world affairs, especially not in European affairs. Now, you should be on your Unit 6 Introduction to American Imperialism note sheet on the wiki, and I'm going to ask you to take some notes while you watch this video. Remember, pause it if you need more time to write down answers or information on your note sheet. And if anything's confusing, you can always go back and replay this. All right, European imperialism. The age of imperialism was in full swing by the end of the 19th century. Strong European nations controlled weaker colonies to gain economic and military advantage. European powers claimed most of Africa, Asia, and the Pacific Islands. Great Britain and France were the primary imperialist powers, but other nations from Germany to Portugal and even tiny Belgium had colonies as well. They often exercised brutal control, exploiting the native peoples and their natural resources for European gain. Those natural resources included rubber, cotton, and ivory. And as you can see from the map and the key, the United States is not involved in any of this at this time, but would be soon. Colonies made European nations wealthy. Many American politicians were convinced that the United States, in order to gain economic power, should follow the imperialist model and establish its own colonies. Alfred Thayer Mahan. One of the principal advocates of imperialism was the American naval officer Alfred Thayer Mahan. An advocate is somebody who calls for something or argues on behalf of something. In his 1892 book, The Influence of Sea Power Upon History, he wrote that a great nation required a powerful navy to protect its overseas trade. In the United States, Mahan's books were read with enthusiasm by a young Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Theodore Roosevelt. He favored American expansion and was determined to build up the U.S. Navy. Naval ships of the time were powered by coal and could only travel a few thousand miles on the fuel they carried. Mahan argued that countries should secure strategically located bases where the fleets could refuel. The United States found opportunities for expansion quickly enough. U.S. troops seized control of Hawaii in 1893. Following a brief revolution organized by white landowners from America against the native Hawaiian government of Queen Liliuokalani, Congress made the seizure permanent, proclaiming Hawaii an American territory in 1898. Native Hawaiians did not have a say in the decision. The annexation of Hawaii secured the territory for American fruit and sugar companies. It also gave the growing U.S. Navy a secure refueling base halfway across the Pacific Ocean, just as Alfred Thayer Mahan had suggested. Those fruit growers, by the way, on Hawaii included the Dole family, and the base that was established in Hawaii was known as Pearl Harbor. Today, it's still a naval base for the United States. Conflict over Cuba. American expansionism was initially sparked by conflict over the Spanish colony of Cuba, one of the last remaining pieces of Spain's Latin American empire. In 1895, Cubans launched a revolution to overthrow Spanish rule. Spain responded by forcing people sympathetic to the rebels into concentration camps. Thousands died from starvation and disease. Americans learned about the conflict from newspapers, in particular the New York papers, owned by millionaires William Randolph Hearst and Joseph Pulitzer. The papers published exaggerated stories of Spanish brutality and aggressively pushed for U.S. military intervention or involvement in Cuba. William Randolph Hearst owned the New York Journal. Joseph Pulitzer owned the New York World. These stories inflamed American popular opinion against Spain and increased the newspaper's circulation and profits. This style of journalism became known as the yellow press, or sometimes yellow journalism.